Good afternoon. My name is Annalise Orlick, and I teach in history and women's and gender studies, and I'm a fellow in this year's GRID seminar, and it is my pleasure to introduce the panel this afternoon. But actually, as I've been instructed, I will introduce Robin Morgan, and Robin Morgan will introduce the other panelists, Soraya Chemaly, Hannah Giorgis, and Zerlina Maxwell. So without further ado, this is a GRID seminar event, and I welcome you all. So I'm going to try to do this quickly, but not too quickly. Robin Morgan has had a remarkable career as an activist, journalist, editor, poet, novelist, and playwright. And it is a more than 50-year-long career in the public eye. So there's a lot to say, and I won't get nearly all of it in, but I'm going to try to give you a flavor. Before becoming one of the most visible leaders of the 1970s women's movement, Morgan had already had a rather busy life. Raised by a single mother in what she called an apostate Jewish household, Morgan was a child star in New York radio in the 1940s and had a regular role in the sentimental 1950s television series, I Remember Mama. She moved from that beginning to become an activist in the New York Congress of Racial Equality and a fierce opponent of the Vietnam War, which brought her briefly to work with the Youth International Party, better known as the Yippies, the 1960s organization famed for outrageous political theater, something that Morgan herself would become known for in the years that followed. Morgan broke with the New Left over its rampant and often egregious sexism. In 1967, along with a group of New York intellectuals, artists, and activists, including the painter and political theorist Shulamit Firestone, she co-founded New York Radical Women. The following year, working with flamboyant African-American attorney Flo Kennedy, they led widely covered protests at the Miss America pageant in Atlantic City, New Jersey, where women protesters paraded in aprons with mops and vacuum cleaners, crowned a sheep Miss America, and threw bras, girdles, false eyelashes, and copies of Playboy and Ladies' Home Journal into a Freedom trash can. That was so much fun, they decided to do more. After Atlantic City, Morgan and her comrades created the political theater group WITCH, the Women's International Terrorist Conspiracy from Hell, in recognition of their belief that, witches and gypsies were the original guerrillas and resistance fighters, close quote, which favored hexes and zaps over traditional political actions. And I could tell you a lot, but very quickly, a couple wearing masks and rags, they staged a Halloween hex on Wall Street to try to bring the Dow down. They invaded a bridal fair in Madison Square Garden wearing black veils and singing "Here Come the Slaves Off to Their Graves" to the tune of the Bridal March. And they threw birth control pills at Texas Senator Ralph Yarborough at a 1970 U.S. Senate hearing on family planning at which no women were invited to testify. In the early 70s, Morgan participated in occupations of Grove Press, Penthouse, and Ladies' Home Journal offices to protest failure to promote women journalists, to protest sexist editorial content, unfair working conditions for low-wage women workers, and in the case of Grove, failure to pay fair royalties on the writings of Malcolm X to his family, his widow Betty Shabazz, and the black community in New York. Morgan and the occupiers demanded more women in editorial positions, daycare facilities for workers, and insisted that profits from the sale of pornography with which Grove subsidized its other publishing ventures be used to create a prostitutes' bail fund. In 1970, Morgan edited and published the groundbreaking collection Sisterhood is Powerful, one of the first anthologies of writings from all quarters of the women's liberation movement. Expansive and encompassing, the collection included voices of a wide range of women activists writing about race, class, sexuality, ageism, body image, colonialism, and sexist media representations of women, among other issues. It was named by the New York Public Library one of the 100 most important books of the 20th century. In 1984, Morgan built on that, editing the first comprehensive collection on the international women's movement, Sisterhood is Global. That same year, she co-founded the Sisterhood is Global Institute with French feminist philosopher Simone de Beauvoir and women activists from 80 countries. The first global feminist think tank and NGO, Sisterhood is Global, has worked on issues of violence against women, organizing women in Muslim countries, and making visible women's unpaid labor around the world. In 2003, Morgan published Sisterhood is Forever, the women's anthology for a new millennium, in which she brought together feminist writings by activists from the 70s, 90s, and early 21st century. Morgan was also responsible for helping to create other important feminist institutions. She was an editor at Ms. Magazine for many years. In the 1970s, she co-founded the National Network of Rape Crisis Centers, the Feminist Women's Health Network, and the National Domestic Violence Refuge Network, which coordinated work among local women's rape crisis centers, health clinics, and battered women's shelters. In 2005, along with feminist icon Gloria Steinem and actress Jane Fonda, Morgan co-founded the Women's Media Center. Since that time, she has again hosted her own weekly radio show, as she did at the age of five. Streamed in 100 countries, her weekly show allows Morgan and guests to discuss a range of women's issues, from Black Girls' Lives Matter, to organizing by low-wage workers, to Hillary Clinton's presidential campaign. Recently diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, Morgan has now turned her writing and activism to a new cause, pushing for more research and resources for women facing this debilitating disease. Morgan is the author of 22 books, essays, a memoir, poetry, novels, and plays. Her articles have appeared in the New York Times, The Guardian, the LA Times, The New Republic, Ms., and many other venues. She has never shied away from controversy or from expressing anger, and her words have inspired many and offended some too. Through it all, Morgan has remained active and visible for more than six decades. In 2007, she was given a Humanist Heroine Award from the Humanist Society, and Morgan offered this reflection on her decades of struggle. 40 years ago, I couldn't get credit or a driver's license in my own name when I was married. Battery and rape victims were blamed, even in the law, for being victimized. Rape in marriage was perfectly legal, as was date rape and acquaintance rape. Girls and women didn't do sports, and the thought of a female Secretary of State, two, one white and one black, and a major presidential candidate who was a woman, forget about it. It took 100 years, basically, to win suffrage in this country. I'd say we're about halfway through the contemporary wave of feminism in the United States. Robin Morgan.
Thank you. I'm missing people in the very first, it's because I'm a shrimp, but I'm still missing. You wanna come over, whatever. No, it's just, maybe I can tilt it. Nah, I need to stand. It's okay. It's fine. It's just one or two people I can't see, and they can't see. It's fine.
Oh, yeah, actually, you can use a personal mic, and then you can stand.
I don't want to stand.
Okay.
I'm happy where I am.
Okay.
It's okay.
Okay, all right. Okay.
It's
I can
okay.
Put this down.
I have to say a little aside, which is that when we hexed Wall Street to make the Dow go down, we did this whole guerrilla theater thing, and then we came back at 3 o'clock in the morning and poured. At that point, they still had these huge brass doors with actual keyholes, and we poured crazy glue in the locks. So the next morning, then we threw a press conference and we said, we hexed them yesterday, and now they will not be able to open. And they went, ha 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 ha. And then they tried to, and they, of course, didn't open. And the stock market couldn't open that day for 9 hours. Well, they had to take the doors down. So I'm just saying that when you do guerrilla theater, you follow it up with a little guerrilla action. It's just not that I would cross straight lines to incite anything. God knows. All right. I want to get to these remarks and get through them as fast as possible because we have a really wonderful panel that I want to hear from, and also you all, the audience. You may know that just recently, six writers resigned in protest from PEN America. There's PEN International, the writers' group, and PEN America. When there was a decision at PEN to award Charlie Hebdo a Freedom of Expression Award, so it was back in the news. And I'm going to use that as a sort of jumping-off place into talking about who pays for free speech. The debate that the horror of Charlie Hebdo, can everybody hear? Okay. The debate that the horror that Charlie Hebdo was inspired is really crucial. Were the magazine editors free speech martyrs, or were they aggressive provocateurs whose so-called satire was not very thinly burkaed racism? France has a history, of course, of restrictions on free speech, from the Louis through Robespierre, and from the arrest of Tom Paine to Napoleon to the Nazis, and that in turn has inspired a seeming obsession with violating all rules. Here in the United States, with a more diverse population from the first, thank you very much to conquest, enslavement, and both forced and willing immigration, we are still wrestling with developing sensitivity about racial and ethnic stereotypes and caricatures. In other words, when is free speech hate speech? Personally, I love words. I have a lifelong, more even than politics, I have a lifelong passion for words. I really do believe that they're logos, that their breath. Logos did not mean the spirit of any religion, it meant breath. And I, as a writer, and particularly as a poet, I'm in love with the English language, which is an ungendered language. I think how hard it must be to be a feminist, and there are many, in a gendered language where everything, table and chair, has a gender. But we're blessed with the English language that way, and a number of other languages are ungendered. So I value free speech deeply. I value it, in fact, too much to be a free speech absolutist. Neither, by the way, were the framers of the Constitution, because the First Amendment is clear. So let's deal with that and get that out of the way right at the get-go. The government may not censor citizens' speech. That is what the First Amendment says. The government, period. That does not mean the rights of corporations to buy elections in secret, as in the Citizens United decision. That is not, money is not speech. It also does not mean that feminists who critique violent pornography as a form of propaganda against women are stifling anybody's free speech. On the contrary, they are exercising free speech. So there's a real confusion that goes on. Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, the great jurist, was also not an absolutist when he wrote, although not as binding law, that shouting fire unnecessarily in a crowded theater was not a First Amendment issue, it were protected. Why? Because it could get people killed, which is in fact what happened with Charlie Hebdo. He said that crying fire in a crowded theater was dangerous, and I'm not blaming the cartoonists. It's not their fault that they were murdered, so please be clear. It is to say, however, that the white male editorial staff was so busy indulging their own worldview and their adolescent definition of humor, and so busy crowing that they were skewering everybody, that they didn't notice that they hadn't included skewering a white male perception of reality. And people of color, and women in particular, all women, live in an alternate reality. They hadn't included the notion that mocking the powerful is what real satire is about. The cheap shot in making fun of the powerless has a long tradition. It echoes from a cruel, well-worn tradition. Nazi anti-Semitic cartoons, Ku Klux Klan racist caricatures, lampoons of dumb Mexicans, cunning Asians, alcoholic Irish, gangster Italians, and of course, the cross-cultural, anytime, every place, stereotypes of women. The big-bosomed, dumb farmer's daughter, the warty old witch, the prissy schoolmarm, the domineering wife, the insatiable femme fatale, the bad mother. Charlie Hebdo had a sexist and homophobic reputation as well. Tom Spurgeon of the Comics Reporter website, and also the wonderful cartoonist Gary Trudeau, have pointed out that Charlie Hebdo had a more savage doing it for the sake of doing it spirit than many younger cartoonists who now get the point that you don't get the point of the privilege, and that you don't need to insult downtrodden people in order to make your points. Nor is it funny, I would add. But hey, it's a joke, can't you take a joke? Is the standard response. It's always the first and last refuge of the entitled scoundrel. No, brothers, people in pain have difficulty getting the joke, especially when the joke is made by the people who put you in pain to begin with. That's really, you know, a challenge. This nonetheless remains a standard response, and it is all over the internet. I'm not going to go into detail on internet bullying and verbal as well as sometimes offline literal violence, particularly against women, because there are members of the panel who are expert on that. But the response of "it's a joke" is another way of controlling public space, which is in fact what this is really about. So we have to ask the basic question: how long are we going to indulge a privileged, sophomoric, patriarchal outrageousness that deliberately wants to give offense? And how long will we mistake it for satire? So a minute about satire. Satire is a form of literature. Satire is a form of political protest. It's a form of wit, for God's sake. Alexander Pope wrote satire. I'm not fond of his style, but he did write satire. Jonathan Swift wrote satire. Mark Twain and Dorothy Parker and Molly Ivins and Jane Wagner wrote satire. Whoopi Goldberg and Stephen Colbert and the brilliant Key and Peele perform satire. These are examples of the values that free speech is in fact designed to protect. And here's the heart of the matter. Vigorously defending racist inanities and sexist propaganda is analogous to defending corporations making limitless campaign contributions. Both of them distort and squander the right originally meant to protect serious political dissent by the citizen against the government. What the framers had in mind was that, you know, Hiram, and they probably meant Hiram, not Miriam, could nail a protest against the town hall door, against the king or against the governor of the Commonwealth or what, and not be jailed for it. That's what the First Amendment was meant to address. There's another element in our free speech sort of befuddlement, the way that this has got confused in the public discourse. We can tend also to veer in another direction, which I would call a purist kind of tyranny, where we use language to avoid facing reality and systems. Systems is a very important word. It's correct line politics, for example, which can become a silencing technique, so that it cuts off dialogue, it cuts off openness, it cuts off hearing, it cuts off learning. It becomes McCarthyism, not Eugene McCarthy, but Joe McCarthy. And if some of you are too young to have experienced it, ask. I don't have time in half an hour to go into Joe McCarthy. It was really bad. It is a kind of McCarthy. It's a central committee type of thinking, which values hierarchy and ranking and purism more than addressing the suffering that goes on about the problem. So if I'm incorrect, and it's based on a guilt politics as well. So if I'm incorrect because I'm privileged, then you must be more incorrect because of a word you used or a word you didn't use. And it becomes a ranking matter. And the ranking is less important than looking at the linking. It does satisfy the ego, but it obscures the problem, and it keeps us from seeing how to address the problem. I will give you a perfect example, which is the N-word. There are a whole lot of folks who are running around. I see people getting nervous already, which is interesting because this kind of obfuscation creates fear, and people can't learn in fear. People can't hear each other in fear. The N-word, like any other word, is a collection of consonants and vowels. What's the problem is not the word. What's the problem is the intent behind the word, the way the word gets used, the history of the word. And for that, you have to look to systematical racism. But if you're running around saying, well, I don't use the N-word, and you think that means you're not a racist, if you're running around saying, well, I don't use the C-word, and you fill in the blank on that one, I'm not a sexist, then it's intellectually lazy, and it's lazy in terms of action, and it keeps you from the real stuff. But it's an easy way out. Okay, back to France for just a minute. Millions of people marched and demonstrated and movingly declared themselves Je suis Charlie. For a confusion of reasons, I think. mostly good-hearted sentimentality and a lot of abstractions, sort of, you know, hazy, cottony abstractions. Unity, free speech, down with terrorism, also guilt for French anti-Semitism, going way back even before the Dreyfus Affair, because in France and in many European countries, the one thing that is in fact illegal, with all the celebration of free speech of Charlie Hebdo, is to deny the Holocaust, which is interesting, an interesting exception. Tell it to the Palestinians. And the other element that was in the marches was anger. And this was anger at being made afraid, huh? At experiencing a new omnipresent fear, which is what the disenfranchised experience 24/7, lifelong, as daily normalcy. I wondered as I watched the march, will that many people ever march for immigrants' rights? Will that many heads of state ever lead them? There's one last factor, a central one that I explored in The Demon Lover, my book, The Demon Lover. It's the left-right circular dominoes game that the Charlie Hebdo guys, all regarding themselves as leftists, played with the assassins. The former provoke the latter. It's a dare. It's exciting. It's something tough guys do. And it sells papers. The assassins, real tough guys, competing to be even tougher, strike back, in turn provoking the ultra-right, which gains followers in, guess what, anti-immigrant, anti-Muslim, anti-dark-skinned people campaigns. Now, who in hell, for this in fact is hell, benefits from this contest in what I can only call provocative manhood, which is what, at heart, this is. You have to add provocative manhood and as yet another element into the extremely complex mix of agony that is Baltimore and so many other American cities right now. Did any of you see the remarkable mother? The mother who was chasing her son who was like way taller than her and making him go home? I love this woman with a passion. She was furious, and she later gave an interview saying, he's my only son, and I don't want him dead. And I thought, you know, we really have to rule the world. That woman has to be queen of the world, because her values were for life. They were not death values. They were not, I mean, he must have been mortified, and he would have to face all of his, oh my God, his mama chased him home. But I fell in love with her, and it is true that although women have been on the streets protesting in cities across this country, protesting the racism in various police departments, and the systemic racism, I might add, you have not seen women doing violent acts. And there's something to be examined about that. Meanwhile, back in France, everybody's left, the headlines are over, the heads of state staged their appearances and departed. They returned to countries where as in France, it's a crime to deny the Holocaust, which is the past, but apparently not to deny the present. They can burn down Roma encampments. They can desecrate both Jewish cemeteries and mosques. They can pay pimps to buy sex with 12-year-old little girls. All of this is called forms of speech. Clearly, suffering has to take place on an epic scale for it to be sufficiently noticed, much less satirized. So who pays for free speech? Well, if defined by the powerful, the powerless pay. And as the powerless come to voice, all those voices, our voices, inform and transform the entire dialogue because they speak from a totally different reality. The Women's Media Center yearly publishes an annual report on the status of women in media, and it shows one reason why we don't hear about that reality. It's free, it's online, you go to womensmediacenter.com, and the statistics on the status of women in all forms of media, online and off, print, broadcasting, book reviews, book publishing, you name it, radio, television, it just, you know, will make you crazy, but will make you want to do something about it, because basically women are 36% of the bylines of the less when you move up the food chain of the editors, of the people who own the papers, of the people who control the news. And it's true of entertainment as well. So that's part of the same problem. But as we nonetheless begin to come to voice in all those areas of systemic sexism and systemic racism, there's a huge transformation that takes place. And it does have to do with freedom and with free speech and with the origins etymologically of the word logos, because logos means breath. And we all need to breathe, because now none of us can breathe except the powerful. We can't breathe. And this is a way of giving breath to ourselves and to each other and to the future. Thank you very much. I'm going to introduce the panel, and then I'm going to go and sit down and listen to them. And we're going to start with, in the middle, with Hannah Giorgis, who is an alum who graduated from Dartmouth in 20... Yay! She's a graduate from 2013, is a writer and organizer whose work addresses the intersections of race, gender, immigration, and pop culture. She's a contributing writer for the U.S. for the Guardian's U.S. opinion section, and her work has also appeared many places: BuzzFeed, OK Africa, Quartz, The Hairpin, and The Toast, among others. She's a member of the New York City chapter of national activist organization Black Youth Project 100 and a former co-president of Dartmouth's Women of Color Collective. Hannah was also a Center for Gender and Student Engagement intern during her time on campus, and her blog, which she started during her sophomore year, can be found at ethiopian.com. To her left, at the edge of the table, is Zerlina Maxwell, a political analyst, a speaker, and a contributing writer for Ebony.com, Mike.com, and RHRealityCheck.org. Zerlina writes about national politics, candidates, and specific policy and culture issues, including domestic violence, sexual assault, victim blaming, and gender inequality. She's consulted with the U.S. Department of State to promote the use of social media by students in the West Bank, and she's a frequent speaker at colleges, universities, and organizations about rape culture and feminism. She was profiled in the New York Times as a top political Twitter voice, yay, to follow during the 2012 election season, and she was selected by Time as one of the best Twitter feeds in 2014. Her writing has also appeared in the New York Daily News, the Washington Post, it goes on and on and on, and she has a law degree from Rutgers Law School and a BA in International Relations from Tufts University. Yay, Zerlina. And at this end of the table is Soraya Chemaly, who was recently named director of the Women's Media Center Speech Project. She's an award-winning feminist writer, a media critic, and an activist whose work focuses on women's rights and the role of gender in politics, religion, and popular culture. She was one of the primary organizers of a successful social media campaign demanding that Facebook recognize misogynistic content as hate speech, and she's the head of the Safety and Free Speech Coalition, which works with social media platforms to affect gender neutrality reforms. She's frequently called upon expert in the relationship between expression of freedom of expression, violence, and gender. She serves on the boards of the Women's Media Center, Women Action and the Media, In This Together Media, Common Sense Media, and Force, Upsetting Racial Rape Culture. This is the distinguished panel, and we'll start with Hannah.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Okay. Hi, thank you all for having me back. It's weird. It is satisfying and somber and mostly very strange to be back here. So it's, I think, before I say anything else or sort of before I launch into what I've been ruminating on when I think about free speech and who pays for it, I just want to ground everything that I'm going to say by first honoring the legacies of resistance that I inherit on this graveyard of a campus. So this soil holds the blood and the brilliance of the people who were lost in its conquest. So the Abenaki people on whose land this colonial project continues to take place. The enslaved African people whose history at this institution is so often erased. I am one piece of the mosaic of their continuing resistance here, and so nothing I tell you today is going to be new. I have loved reading since I was old enough to string words together. When I'm sad, I read. When I'm happy, I read. When nothing in the world makes sense, I read. When I was at Dartmouth, that was more often than not. I still refuse to believe that the polar bear plunge is a thing that people do seriously and with passion. I don't get it. I never will. But anyway, I read. a bit of background. So the polar bear plunge happens every year. During winter carnival, people jump into Occam Pond, which is frozen over. Yes, it's frozen. People jump into it. They have to be harnessed, and then they paddle through it for a little bit. Out of the pond. It's wild. It's wild, and people do it every year, and it's like this Dartmouth badge of honor. It's weird. I never did it. I never will. But in all seriousness, words are how I see through the din, how I wade through chaos. They help me process the world around me when everything feels unfamiliar, and give me a way to articulate the things that I know best. But words, liberatory though they may sometimes be, can also carry their own set of restraints. At Dartmouth, I felt those most intimately when I tried to engage in any sort of dialogue or activism that centered the needs of communities that do not fit into the model crafted of the Dartmouth sun. White, affluent, cisgender, heterosexual, and hypermasculine. When I spoke up, no matter how calmly or rationally, I was called angry, as though the adjective were not a state of being, but a character trait woven into my very DNA by virtue of black womanhood alone. In that sense, my speech has never been free. Legendary black feminist theorist Dr. Patricia Hill Collins outlined the rhetorical tightropes we must walk when we try to speak from the margins. She said, "Oppressed groups are frequently placed in the situation of being listened to only if we frame our ideas in the language that is familiar to and comfortable for a dominant group. This requirement often changes the meaning of our ideas and works to elevate the ideas of dominant groups." At Dartmouth, that meant I couldn't call things what they were. Violent acts of aggression, attacks on my very humanity itself, were not allowed to be called that. Culture of violence does not look good in a press release from the Office of Public Affairs, and certainly not in an email from a college president who is himself a member of one of the houses most infamous for the acts he is charged with limply reprimanding. For this college, the lubrication of liquid funds from powerful alumni makes limp words like bias incident and extreme behavior easier to swallow than their more honest counterparts, racism, hazing, rape, etc. But words do not simply describe power and how it is wielded. They are themselves power. Toni Morrison, queen of planet Earth, taught us this when she said, "Oppressive language does more than represent violence. It is violence. Does more than represent the limits of knowledge. It limits knowledge. Whether it is obscuring state language or the faux language of mindless media, whether it is the proud but calcified language of the academy or the commodity-driven language of science, whether it is the malign language of law without ethics or language designed for the estrangement of minorities, hiding its racist plunder in its literary cheek, it must be rejected, altered, and exposed. It is the language that drinks blood, laps vulnerabilities, tucks its fascist boots under the crinolines of respectability and patriotism as it moves relentlessly toward the bottom line and the bottomed out mind. Sexist language, racist language, theistic language, all are typical of the policing languages of mastery and do not permit new knowledge or encourage the mutual exchange of ideas." So what are the stakes of not being allowed to challenge or interrogate prevailing narratives in the context of an institution that purports to educate? What does it mean that this institution threatens to serve protesters with disciplinary action for interrupting a musical skit, but does not expel the legion of rapists hiding in its classrooms? If we understand that the vast majority of the literary and historical canon in the US has thus far served as glorified propaganda for its ruling class, that knowledge production has either buffered or caused the many social ills from which this country suffers, and because of which this country's most vulnerable are always suffering, we will remember that knowledge and its cousin speech are not neutral. This nation's greatest intellectual heroes were and are monsters. George Washington extracted teeth from his slaves to make dentures for himself. Thomas Jefferson was a slaveholding child rapist. Martin Heidegger was a racist and anti-Semite. Hegel paved the way for the scientific racism that classified people of color as non-human. The Academy frames their violence as unrelated to their intellectual endeavors, as though one can simply extract a tooth from a living, breathing human being in the morning for your own cosmetic purposes, and then create an equitable document by which to govern a nation in the afternoon. Speech and intellectual creation are deeply informed by the climate in which they occur. To pretend otherwise is disingenuous. When our definitions of intellectualism, of reason, of logic, of what is and is not theory, are defined by proximity to white masculinity, the consequences are quite literally life or death. We who are not worthy of voice are deemed unworthy of life too. Last month in Baltimore, Freddie Gray died with his spine severed and his voice box crushed. In the custody of law enforcement who serve the interests of a state that has defined him by virtue of his blackness as non-human. So when Alpha Delta has a party themed Bloods and Crips, we see those two things as occurring in combination with one another. To be defined as a caricature of yourself is to be defined as non-human. Stories about marginalized people are then written in our blood. Every time we speak into the void, every time we scream into the wilderness that shrouds our dead bodies in ivy, it is a radical act. We take back our personhood when we demand to be both subjects and scribes of our own lives, and to people who want to keep our existences in the footnotes, that is a threat. To return to Toni Morrison, critics don't generally associate black people with ideas. They see marginal people. They see just another story about black folks. They regard the whole thing as sociologically interesting, perhaps, but very parochial. There's a notion out in the land that there are human beings one writes about, and that there are black people, or Indians, or some other marginal group. If you write about the world from that point of view, somehow it is considered lesser. But we are people, not aliens. We live, we love, and we die.
Debate that I did on Fox News. I'm political analyst, and so occasionally I go and debate politics on television. Sometimes it's a little less tricky. I mean, like if you're going to MSNBC, for example, it's a little friendlier than when you send me, a Democrat black woman, to Fox News. but occasionally there's a moment where I'm debating a cultural issue, and so this debate on Hannity is one in which I was essentially debating whether or not it would be a good idea, one side of the argument, to put concealed guns on college campuses, and me on the other side of the argument, where I say, that's not a great idea. but they were also, I mean, all joking aside, they were essentially presenting this as an idea for rape prevention on college campuses. So if we arm every woman on a college campus, then there will be no rapes on a college campus. So goes their logic, right? So I'm going to play the clip, and I'm going to demonstrate afterwards how essentially when you are a woman, particularly a woman of color, in a media space and you're talking about these very sensitive issues, I'm a survivor and so I'm talking from the first person perspective as well, how it can be a very, very tricky terrain after the fact because of what happens to you, just because you dare to have an opinion and express it in public. So I have it queued up. I thought I had it queued up. Okay. It's not here anymore, but that's not gonna. Is this somebody's video that somebody needed? Okay, so I can just pull it up. It was queued up, but somebody's. Alright. Apologies for that. Alright, there we go.
The arrogance of the left was on full display yesterday in Colorado during a hearing on gun control measures. Democratic State Senator Evie Hudak lectured a rape survivor who was testifying that she wished that women would be allowed to carry concealed weapons on college campuses. Now watch this exchange filmed by the Denver Post.
The harsh reality as a woman is that a firearm is the one equalizing factor when met against an opponent much larger than me. The question of my life is and will remain to be, what would have been different if I had been able to carry my firearm that night?
Thank you for sharing your story. Very, very unsettling story. I just want to say that actually statistics are not on your side, even if you had had a gun. You said that you were a martial arts student, and yet, I mean, person experienced in Taekwondo, and yet because this individual was so large, was able to overcome you even with your skills. And chances are that if you had had a gun, then he would have been able to get that from you and possibly use it against you. Yeah. I mean, the Colorado Coalition Against Gun Violence says that
just wait.
For every one woman who used a handgun to kill someone in self-defense, 83 were murdered by them.
And that statistic has been debunked, by the way. Joining me now with reaction, Democratic strategist Zerlina Maxwell, senior fellow at the Independent Women's Forum, Gail Trotter. This really angers me. She wasn't there. She doesn't know what this young girl went through. This young girl is saying, if I had my gun, which I've been trained to use, I could have defended myself. She doesn't know any better. What's wrong with these people in Colorado?
Well, her comments are insulting and absurd because she's trying to take away someone else's personal choice. The Second Amendment, the statistics show that the Second Amendment affects women mostly because it has a disproportionate impact.
But you know what? This is not the first time, Zerlina, and we were talking about it beforehand, about what women have been recommended that they use whistles and what, pens, that they fake faint, urinate, puke on people, the most idiotic things that have been said by these arrogant, ignorant politicians out
there. Well, I think that the entire conversation is wrong. I don't want anybody to be telling women anything. I don't want men to be telling me what to wear, how to act, not to drink. And I don't, honestly, want you to tell me that I needed a gun in order to prevent my rape. And in my case, don't tell me if I had only had a gun, I wouldn't have been raped, because
You have written about this.
I have, yes.
That this happened to you.
Yes. And I was attacked by someone I knew. Mm-hmm. So you're required, what you're saying works out in reality, not in a theoretical scenario, you're requiring that I shoot someone that I know?
No, I'm not.
That is not the reality. Two-thirds of women are attacked by someone
Nobody
they know.
Nobody is requiring that you do it. I have carried a weapon my entire adult life, and I've had license to carry in the five recent states that I've lived in, and I am trained, I'm a marksman in the use of a pistol. I have been since I'm 11 years old. I've been a good shot. Only if women choose to, they ought to have the right. That ought to be their choice. And if you choose not to, I fully respect that. I would urge you to bring every woman to have some way to defend themselves.
And every year there are 2.5 million defensive uses of guns.
Right.
Every year. And the people have done these studies. Gary Kleck, he's a lifelong Democrat. He's a member of the ACLU. So this is a legitimate study that shows that people use guns to defend themselves.
And this is what they're denying women. They're telling them to use a ballpoint pen. A ballpoint pen?
That's ridiculous as well, but I don't think that we should be telling women anything. I think we should be telling men not to rape women and start the conversation there.
Well, criminals are not going to listen to that.
No, but
so I agree with you.
We're not. I mean, yes, but men are committing a crime, but many
but
of the men that commit rape are people
to
that
Sean
you know.
Hannity. No man should do that to anybody.
You're talking about it as if there's some faceless, nameless criminal. When it a lot of times it's someone that you know and trust.
Well, I'm saying that women need to know that these situations arise, and we've got to, evil exists in the world.
Yes,
evil exists.
We can prevent rape by telling men not to commit it.
No, that's not right.
Criminals will not listen.
No, we're not talking about criminals. We're talking about a cultural.
I want women to be able to protect themselves, don't you?
I want women to be able to protect themselves, yes, but I want women to not be in this situation.
And
but they're going to be in that
no,
situation.
No, that's not true. If you train men not to grow up to become rapists, you think
you can tell a rapist to stop doing what he's doing?
Yes.
You really? And he's going to listen to an ad campaign?
There are organizations that do this. Men can stop rape. Men stopping violence. They train young men.
Listen.
to not rape.
And you think over you could stop every rapist?
Over 90% of violent crime in the U.S. occurs without a firearm. And when you look at these studies that say women are more likely to be raped than to be able to defend themselves.
If firearms were the answer, then the military would be the safest place for women, and it's not.
But knowing that there are evil people, I want women protected. And they've got to protect themselves. But thank you both. I'm sorry that happened. It shouldn't happen to anybody. Coming up next, it is the gun rights ad that is already igniting a huge controversy. It links the left's assault.
So that's Hannity. Wait, you play slideshow. Okay. So that's Hannity, and I know that I don't have a lot of time, but I wanted to play the clip for context because what happened to me after the fact is actually an example of how people in the public sphere, particularly women journalists who try to approach these conversations, not even just on Fox News, but anywhere, on the internet, on TV, on radio, essentially what happens to them afterwards is you become an internet meme or you get threats of rape and death, right? So this is a meme that a conservative website started that was shared so many times on Facebook it ended up in feeds of people that I knew. And next, less funny, is the rape and death threats I got immediately after this segment. And so this was my first sort of foray into sort of the world of conservative online trolling. I you know, mostly at that point, I'd only had people just be like, you're stupid liberal, whatever. But this was a new sort of terrain, and it actually made it very clear that not only was sort of my speech limited in the effect that like I expressed a point of view that was, you know, diverged from what Fox News sort of was accepting at that moment, or people that really love guns are accepting at that moment, but I literally, you know, had to call the police, leave the internet, and get escorted in and out of Fox News for the next few weeks after this segment aired, simply because people threatened me for expressing my opinion. And I also just wanted to, before I close out, is sort of talk about the fact that not only did I go on this segment, but I also tried to explain sort of in more specific terms right afterwards for Ebony what I meant by teach men not to rape, right? Because a lot of people, you know, in a 5-minute segment, it's really hard to articulate all of the different ideas. I really tried really hard to go back to the same points, as you could tell. And so I sort of explained here, you can see the 5 ways I was trying to express that you can actually teach people to not commit sexual assault. It's actually something that you can work towards when people are very young. And then lastly, this is more recent, after the Rolling Stone incident, you know, debacle, we should call it, I wrote this for the Washington Post really to reshift the public conversation around the issue of sexual assault, because I actually, you know, when Rolling Stone puts the word discrepancies in a statement, it then sort of leads the general public to say, oh, she lied, right? That's the sort of assumption there. And so part of, I feel, my job as an advocacy journalist is to use the platform that I have to reframe conversations when I see that they're happening in a really unhelpful way. And so that was my attempt to do that. And again, this is years later after the segment, but again, a week of death threats just because of this article. This article got me death threats. And so just in terms of, to close, in terms of the free speech part of this, it's really a big challenge right now in journalism for women, because the leadership, the editors I work with, the editor who edited this piece was a white man, not really understanding. I mean, first they put the word automatically in the title originally, automatically believe, as opposed to generally. And I was also not talking about in the court system, I'm talking about as a moral argument. And so I think that, you know, as women journalists, we have to really struggle with the fact that our leadership is male and white and doesn't understand that this is going to get me death threats for a week and I have to leave the internet. I can't actually use the internet and express my points of view for at least up to a week after really a hotly contested debate like the one on John Hannity, or when I'm doing an op-ed like this to try to reframe the conversation. So I know we're going to have continued dialogue in the Q&A portion, but that's all I have for today. Thank you.
Okay, so I admit that I don't know where on this my presentation is.
Is it in PowerPoint?
Yeah,
also?
It's right here, yeah.
Oh, okay, cool.
It's right here. I get it, slideshow. I'm actually going to ignore it now. Because of the amazing things that everybody said. So I actually just wrote things that I really want to say and then get back to this. What really struck me is the cost of our free speech. And we all experience that every day. I haven't had experiences quite as extreme as Zerlina's, but I've had them regularly in the same way. And the idea that that is free speech, that we use that language, is corrosive to me. And so I like to actually think of what we're aiming for is the liberation of speech, which is a different thing, because we don't have that right now. And one thing that Robin said that struck me was that we have ungendered speech. And I think of it not so much as ungendered as highly binary, right? So black and white, male and female, gay and straight. And he said, she said, that's a very common one, right? And that has real effects on the way we can express ourselves. And so I'd like us to think about those binaries kind of as we talk during the day, because I know that every time I open my mouth as a brown woman, already I'm not in the binary, right? No one really knows where to quite put me in that framework, right? But as a woman, automatically, my speech is affected by the fact that I am a woman and I am not a man, right? And so one thing, when Robin said this, I thought, okay, so let's think about language, because we need to talk about language and structure of language. And the structure of our language is very gendered. So if you think about testimony, right, what we just described are testimonial injustices. The disenfranchised don't have credibility, and we live in a system that is optimized to degrade our credibility so that we cannot actually contribute, as philosopher Miranda Flicker, I think, was here a while ago, we can't contribute to the general pool of knowledge, and that creates injustice, epistemological injustice, and real violence that we live with every day. What really strikes me every time I have to write an article and I submit it, and I know that automatically my point of view is going to be the first thing editors think of, is the word testify, testimony, testament, are all in the semantic cluster with testes, right? Because women could not testify in court. And I think, okay, how do you even begin to address that, right? So I want to talk a little bit about knowing and speech, because in our free speech norms, our principles of speech are dedicated to truth and to autonomy, because we're supposed to be able to all contribute to a public dialogue so that we have better governance. But really what we're talking about is the capacity to know in a human way, right? And we're not given that capacity of knowing because of our identities. So the context for the kind of harassment that we have experienced, that we talk about, that, you know, it's nothing new. It's been in the public sphere forever. If you have not read Mary Beard on the harassment of women in the public sphere, you should do that just for fun, because she's a good writer and the history's interested. I'm going to quickly go through these things because I'd like to broaden what we think of as free speech and suppression of speech. Objectification, gendered politeness norms with children, the ritualized silencing of women in religion, our obscenity laws, and double standards related to the way we can express ourselves with our bodies, male-dominated media, white male-dominated media in this country. In other countries, it's other things. Race and sex mutually construct each other here in incredibly dynamic ways. In other countries that are not as diverse, it's sex and caste, for example. And so you have to shift your frame if you're in a different environment. And the language and framing that I just talked about. And also the idea that cultural relativism is very gendered. I spend a lot of my time on platform reform with internet companies that are global. So they are effectively transnational speech arbiters. They're making decisions all the time, right? So, I should warn everybody, some of these are very graphic because I need to show them to explain what I'm saying. But these are just regular everyday ads, right? This is the level of everyday objectification and dehumanization of women's bodies that we see. These are from Vogue. They're from Elle, they're from GQ, except one, the one of the woman in the jeans in the center. She's an actual murder victim in Florida. Her husband, who's a police officer, shot her. And as you can tell, there's no difference, right? I mean, you really couldn't pin that out. At the same time, we have these levels of dehumanization, We have what is called now at Facebook the nipple problem. I'm the nipple lady. Because we have this double standard. And all of the harassment and violence that we see takes place in a context already where these types of things happen. So you can have the center picture, which is a Sports Illustrated picture, which verges on complete nudity and pornography. That's totally allowable in Facebook, but you can't have, now you can. You could not have a breastfeeding woman. You could have upskirt photos because non-consensual photography was fine. You couldn't ask for that to be taken down, and now you can. But those were huge changes. Those are parts of what are known as counter-narratives to the objectification and to the hate speech, right? And those counter-narratives continue to be suppressed. So if you're a political protester and you're a woman and you use your body, how many people here knew that 7,000 women in Argentina in December protested at a cathedral in a physical fight with men who had guarded it, and many of them were topless? Did anybody know that? Right? So you would never see that on the front of the New York Times because the women are topless, right? And you also couldn't see it in Facebook. That happens all the time. There are women in Nigeria. There are women in Afghanistan that protest topless because they're so body bound, right? Feminist activists like Femin do it, whether you agree with their politics or not. The fact is they're externalizing violence. They show state violence on a woman's body in a very public space. Art, the entire canon of Western art has naked women, but you couldn't actually show that for a long time in Facebook. Now you can show paintings and some sculpture, but still no photographs showing women's breasts unless it's a post-mastectomy picture, which is something we managed to accomplish in the last 2 years, a breastfeeding photograph, something we managed to accomplish in the last 2 years. But you still can't show a woman walking down the street in New York if she chooses to, even though it's legal there. So what does that mean in other ways? It's not just that women want to free the nipple, that's the name of the movement, because they'd like to walk around on a lark. This has real meaning culturally across the globe. So Brazil is on the verge of suing Facebook because they took down this picture of an indigenous woman dated from 1906. And they consider that a form of colonialism, right? It's censorship. This is not pornography. All of these images conflate, the censorship of these images conflate women's nakedness with obscenity. And when you do that, you can't actually talk about the real obscenity. Right? We can't have a real conversation about the nuances of pornography if we consider a breastfeeding woman pornographic and obscene, right? So what struck me about this, though, last week is that on the one hand, Brazil was saying, hey, put our photograph back. But here in the United States, there was an entire indigenized Zuckerberg movement because Facebook has an anonymous names policy, right? There's a real name policy, which has resulted in indigenous people's names and accounts being removed because someone's making decisions about what counts as a real name, right? These two need to collide, right? I mean, you can see them happening in space, and they're the same issue, and they are suppressions of speech. An example of how that cultural idea, how that cultural relativism plays out globally is that you have euphemisms in the media like child marriage, right? An oxymoron, child prostitution, another oxymoron. In Facebook, last year after a young Yemeni girl who was married at the age of 10 was raped to death, someone in another country decided that it would make a lot of sense to explain how to rape a child without killing her. And so in an effort to sort of deal with another person's culture, moderators on some of these platforms are like, well, we can't take that down. That's not our culture, right? Which meant that we had to step in and say, actually, no, it's a violation of the girl's human rights. It's graphically violent. No one should be explaining how to rape a 10-year-old. But that was a conversation, right? Because there's no real respect for the fundamental right of a girl not to be raped. That gets lost in the equation of cultural relativism. And it's much more gendered than not because women tend to represent their nations and their cultures in ways that dehumanize them, right? So I'm using Facebook as an example. I want to be really clear about this. Facebook's norms are our norms. The Motion Picture Association of America, the FCC. You know, this is all over the place. Facebook's just a great example because it's so in your face now, right? It's everywhere. It's global. There are a billion people. And so that comes back to the demographics of who's making these decisions. And it's overwhelmingly, in our media, white men. And even saying it that way in spaces feels hostile. Right? People respond with hostility to that. It looks like this globally. All right? This is what it looks like. Now, in our mainstream media, this is what the New York Times shows when they show powerful men who run for office. This is how they portray the women. They look like unhinged, floating in space. We don't even know what to do with the idea of a powerful woman, right? And when we talk about it, we say it's a woman problem, like an addiction or a drug or alcohol, right? So it's at every stage and level. And I think Robin told me I needed to stop, so I may stop too. Oh, I've got to go then. Okay. So this is really important. Socialized speech dominance. Everything I'm talking about starts at a very small scale because parents, in their interactions with children, interrupt girls twice as often as boys. They talk over them. More than 50% of conversations with girls are tied to chores. Teachers, the same thing. Even if the boys are being disruptive, the fact is they're being engaged with 2/3 of the classroom time and observations. And when boys are asked questions, they're much more open-ended and complex. Fast forward 40 years in courtrooms, jurors will believe men and women except when the situation is complex. When the situation's complex, they won't believe a woman, right? So those are really important things. And I believe they're very tied to religiosity because all male clericism undermines female authority. Girls go into these institutions and they learn to be quiet. They learn to be silent. They learn their voices have to be suppressed. They learn that male voices have to be prioritized. It's not like that stays in the place of worship. It walks right out with everybody when it goes, right? And I believe that these are all gendered ways of chilling speech. Racialized in this country, highly racialized in this country. In other countries, there are just other ways, same dynamics. And that's what we described, I believe. We're describing this testimonial injustice. And it undermines our ability to be knowers in society. And that is irrelevant of the kind of media that we're talking about. Okay.
Yeah, we're now just going to sort of talk amongst ourselves for a bit and then take a break, I think, and then we get to talk with the audience. We get to ask the questions. You have to give the answers. I wanted to say one tiny thing. I should have been more specific in my speech. I should have said gendered nouns.
Yes.
Gendered nouns is what I meant in English.
But gendered, you gave me a good thing.
I gave you
yes,
a good
you
thing. You went took and ran with it. You know, fantastic. But one of the things I'd like to start this discussion with is that, as has been mentioned, threats and violence and attacks against people who are trying to change the status quo, in our case, women, are hardly new. But the difference is the technology. I mean, I can't count, the reason my hair is no doubt white, are the death threats over the years. But they used to, unless they showed up with bombs in the auditorium and that meant dogs sniffing around and dramatic stuff like that, or threw rocks at us as we walked into the auditoriums. Usually the threats came to one's publisher or, you know, the organization, and then they were sent on. Now these crazy morons can sit there in their jammies eating Fritos, you know, and just, you know, spew out hatred. So I wanted to ask you all, and I know particularly Zerlina, you're young and you have yet to maybe pull the hell down on your head yet, but I know that Zerlina and Soraya have had enormous heavy threats. It's interesting that you're now beginning to get them from the right wing. We've been getting them from the right wing for a long time. I now also get them from the left.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, like left, right, center, north, south, east, west. It's guys hating us for saying that guys hate us. It's really kind of simple.
Yeah.
So I wonder not only how you cope with it, but what you have, what you're evolving in how you deal with it.
I would say number one is self-care. So I prioritize self-care number one over everything, and informs my work. And I think that, so that includes exercising and trying to eat vegetables and going to a therapist on a regular basis. So that's first. Okay. And if I weren't doing those things, I wouldn't be able to do my job.
That's smart. My generation never did that.
Yeah. So self-care is first. And then obviously the Hannity thing was actually my first time with the sort of just barrage of threats. I mean, like, you know, hundreds of every few minutes in my Twitter feed and then emails and Facebook. I mean, it was awful. But I learned a lot from how going through that. And since, unfortunately, because that happens all the time. That was just the first time that's happened, and it's happened like maybe 10 times since, in terms of the death threats. It depends upon the scale. So I learned a lot from that experience, and one of the things I learned, and this is something that I actually talked to other feminist writers about, is leaving the internet for at least like 48, 72 hours, just completely. And you know, I haven't found a better strategy than that. And that doesn't mean I'm not looking on Twitter or not on the internet. It means that I'm not looking at my mentions. So when I say I'm leaving the internet, I'm leaving sort of the interaction and engagement portion of the internet. Uh-huh. I'm still looking at the news, I'm still looking at my news feed, I'm still looking at my, you know, what people are tweeting, but I'm not looking at what people are tweeting at me, because it's too scary. Mm-hmm. And there's no, I mean, at this point, I have also, as a third sort of thing, is have someone else go through and block and report and screen grab and save the threats so that I don't have to look at it. And that was one of the things I learned from the first experience was, I was looking through a lot of that stuff, and that is not something that you should be doing at all, but particularly if you're a survivor of sexual assault. So for me, it's self-care, number one, like making sure like I'm okay. And then two is leaving the internet. And I also, I guess three, have a cabal of feminists that you sort of, send each other like cat gifts when it gets a little rough out there in the streets. And I think this is true, like even if it's not me, even if it's somebody else who's having, like, you know, Jessica Valenti gets a lot of threats as well, the founder of feministing.com and also a writer for The Guardian. And so I'll just send her like a puppy video if she's like, oh God, you know, somebody's like calling me the C word on my Instagram. And I just posted a picture of my daughter, right? I'll send her like something cute so that it's just like counteracts the negative.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about you?
So I'm really bad at self-care, and I hate exercise more than anything. And I really love chocolate. So I gotta do what you're doing, right? But I admit that when I started writing, I started seeing a therapist.
Yeah.
Because I knew that there was no way that I could do what I needed to do and not do that. I want to point out that comes at great expense.
Yeah.
And there are so many costs associated, frankly, to doing this work, because two things happen simultaneously. One is I started getting these threats, and the first time I got it was because I said this morning. I wrote about why boys should be allowed to cross-gender empathize. It wasn't even about sexualized violence or anything. I just said, let the boys, give them more leeway to express themselves. And I got a hanging threat. And I thought, really? But that was the beginning, right? But at the same time, when I started writing about it, people started sending me things. And they sent videos of their rapes that had been used for extortion. They sent files that the police were ignoring. It was overwhelming, and so I got super annoyed and wrote a letter actually to Sheryl Sandberg, because I don't work for Facebook. I'm not a moderator. And I said, Facebook needs to do something, which is how we got to the point where there was a campaign. I felt extremely, I went from really just writing to thinking, well, this is not happening. We have to do something about this. And so that's evolved into a lot of different activities. And like Zerlina and I belong to a large network of people who are really dedicated to exploring these ideas and to changing the culture. It used to be on the internet, before there were there was so much photo intensity, you could actually represent yourself in ways that didn't mean this happened automatically. But now they're photographs, and that changes everything because it actually reifies old stereotypes and old dynamics in ways that for a very brief moment was not true. So I am very much like, well, we better do something about this immediately because this is not good.
Yeah.
So I want to return to this, but I was about to ask Hannah something. You want to add in this, and then I have a question
for
you, too.
The first time I got a death threat, I was 22, and I was at Dartmouth. Mm-hmm. And it was not because of anything I'd written, because of anything I'd really done. It was because some folks thought that I mistakenly thought, because there's, like, not enough black people here, and people think that we're all the same. people thought that I was part of a protest that I actually hadn't participated in. Mm. And so people thought I was part of that protest, and so I started getting death threats, rape threats, like the whole nine yards. And that was, when I was 22. I mean, I've since dealt with that in various forms throughout my writing career as well, and it is something where I have friends, generally male friends, generally white male friends, who will log onto my account for me and block people and report and screen grab as necessary. But it is something that I deal with and that I've noticed. I've never gotten a threat that isn't racialized. Even when the thing that I've written about is gender, more more prominently, the threats are always racialized.
Mine too.
Yeah. But I have gotten.
Assume you're Muslim ever?
No, not usually, because Ethiopian Christian is such hegemony, so people usually don't. But it's always racialized. Mm. Whenever I get threats, even when they're gender.
I was going to ask you also, Hannah, because there are people here who, you got sprung, you've graduated. but there are people here who are, still serving sentences. and haven't been paroled yet. From the freedom of the not a student anymore, are there things that you could suggest as constructive, really impactful actions for folks who are here, because you have the freedom to speak in a way that they don't. I mean, they can be expelled, or faculty can be fired, or ways you think that could address the kind of systemic problems that you referred to in your remarks.
I think the thing for me is I knew this sort of intuitively when I was here. But like the media cares about this stuff. Like if you find or if you are in touch with particularly women reporters, folks who are writing about these things, like reach out to them all the time because of the way that Dartmouth attracts attention for like any number of things. It's always a story. And that sort of leveraging that, as unfortunate as it is, being like, this is bad PR for you, office of whatever. It works in a way that like, hey, we're human beings. We'd like to have educational experiences that aren't violent. Unfortunately, it doesn't work. Which is, it's terrible, it is what it is, but if that's the way that things are set up, so reach out outside of this space, the bubble is real, but it doesn't have to be in there. People on the other side of that who are invested and just don't really know what's happening because of this, the way that this school packs things in, so in such an insular way.
Well, maybe following on that, maybe the rest of the whole, just free-for-all on I always hate to send people away or even on a break, because we'll come back for Q&A, without suggestions of things to do, because I don't want you to all go away psychotically depressed. and also the point of consciousness is to fuel action. So anything that anybody can suggest, whether it's in terms of online, whether it's in terms of rape culture on campuses or anywhere else, just have at it.
Well, I mean, I'm a big proponent of Twitter. I mean, they said in the intro that my Twitter feed was on the time list. And so Twitter for me is a tool. It's not, a fun waste of time on the internet. I saw the strategic power. Obviously, we all saw that, too, in the Arab Spring. And I, from that moment, was like, how can we make that happen here? And so a lot of my work has been how to leverage the power of Twitter. And obviously we're seeing that, right? You see hashtag Black Lives Matter. I have a Black Lives Matter pin on my coat. That's a hashtag, right? That was started by three women of color, by the way. But that's also one of the one thing that's often left out of all the media coverage, because we're talking about the white male, white dominated media coverage that's
talking about all these issues. So I would say leveraging the power of social media, get engaged. I mean, if you're not on Twitter, you must be on Twitter. Even if you're not, you know, an activist or in politics, I think it works for every industry. But I think getting onto social media spaces and finding out where those conversations are happening, and getting in, you know, jumping into them, and particularly with rape culture, I think that, you know, hashtags around women's issues like Yes All Women, I started a hashtag Rape Culture Is When, another survivor, Wakwatwe Wenjuki, started Survivor Privilege after George Will wrote a column saying that it was a privilege to be a survivor of sexual assault.
Yes.
He gets paid a lot of money to write things like this. And so by leveraging the power of Twitter and using hashtags as a space to have a conversation, because in many ways, in how Second Weavers did it, sort of consciousness raising, I look at Twitter hashtags as a space to have a conversation. So that means that people are, you know, sharing their own experiences with violence, sexual violence, domestic violence. There was also Why I Stayed, Why I Left. Those are two hashtags that started after Ray Rice. So I think that by strategically leveraging the power of Twitter and using hashtags as a space to have a conversation, to reframe the conversation, to talk about your personal narratives if they have to do with that particular topic. I think that, I mean, the media, the mainstream media, CNN, MSNBC, Fox News, they pay attention to what's going on Twitter. And so a lot of times you can make a conversation happen on Twitter and it seems bigger than it actually is, because it goes straight to CNN and Don Lemon, because they're all looking through to see what people are talking about, right? But you also want to make sure Don Lemon's saying the right thing. So part of why hashtags and using them strategically as a space is so important, we saw that with Black Lives Matter in Ferguson, and even all the way up into today, because you had moments in Ferguson where the media would do what they always do, which is basically verbatim repeat what the police say as fact. And you had people picking up tear gas, like, that's not smoke gas canisters, that's tear gas. Here's a picture of it. They just, you know, shot it at me. Here, Don Lemon, CNN, please correct the record, right? And that was something that was happening over and over and over again, because people who are on the ground were using the power of Twitter to fact check the media in real time. And it was happening all in real time. I mean, if you were watching CNN, you were getting a completely distorted view of what was really happening on the ground until they fact checked. because Twitter was really where all of the true stories were happening.
Anybody else? Solutions, go ahead.
So I agree entirely. I'm a Twitter fan too. Yeah. And a lot of bad things happen on Twitter, but I would say overwhelmingly that many more good things happen on Twitter. And as a huge fan of Robin's original transnational feminist world, I also really urge people in this country to pay attention to what's going on in other countries.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Use the media to look at other news sources. Use the technology to reach out to other people who are like-minded, because the most transformational and disruptive thing I think we're living through right now that we don't even really understand the effects of are that girls and women are no longer isolated in their homes. Mm. They can reach out across their walls in very repressive families, in very repressive countries, and I mean like Texas, right? And they can talk to people in other countries, right? And that's super important, and we all, I think, know we do that every day. And then the second thing I would say is get out of the technology space and have the really hard conversations at home. Like, you will look at me and you wouldn't know that I'm half English, right? But I am. That means the men in my family are all white dudes and I love them, right? But you need to be able to use those words, because those words spur people to action. When I write something, and this has happened to me so many times, right? I'll say the only children, you know, when children in this country watch television, boys of color and girls all walk away with low self-esteem. That's a lot of words. If my editor says cut it and I turn it around and I say the only people who leave watching television with high self-esteem are white boys, I get, how do you know that? Where's the research? And I'm like, it's the same research with the first sentence, right? I just switched the language around, because then actually people have a sense of collective guilt and it spurs them to action in a way that they wouldn't otherwise, because the onus isn't on the people who are experiencing the discrimination but the people benefiting from it. That's super hard to do when you are like having coffee in the morning, right? But you have to be able to do it if you're gonna do it in your work or in your school. And so that's what I would say.
You know, I have to tell you, for the people of my generation who are in the audience, you must share the same real thrill that I'm feeling, because these three women, the future's in awfully good hands. And that's not saying I'm handing anybody my torch. Get your own damn torch. Hanging on to my torch. We need every torch to, you know, change this. But the vision and the I also really like Zerlina's take care of self. That is so not in my handbook. I'm trying to learn now, but it's, you know, it's a little late when you're already falling apart. So do it early, because endurance is part of the struggle here. And you gotta, when you realize that it's not a matter of dying for the cause, but it's much harder. It's living for the cause. Yeah. Oh my God. and it's gonna take a long time to turn this around. I'm gonna close this little section. We're gonna take a break and then come back for the next segment of this. With a story, when Soraya mentioned the global women's movement, I realized, oh God, yes, of course, how could I overlook that? But I will close with a story that will tell you my version of the power of the new technology. Many of my generation are sort of still referring to it as the Twitter. when I sat down with Jane, who is an extremely intelligent person, and my co-founder of the Women's Media Center, and I said she had never done the Google. She was on email, but she hadn't done the Google. So I sat down with her, and I introduced her to Google, and it was a magical half an hour. And then after a certain point, she turned to me. She said, "This is fabulous. This is fucking fantastic. Do people know about this?" So I just want you to know that organizing in my own generation is now a full-time job. It's not all I do, but it is a full-time job. I was not on Twitter, mainly because I thought somebody with my first name should not tweet. but once I realized that Robin Tweets was perfectly okay and I could live with it, Twitter is an enormous gift. I couldn't agree more. And just as Tiananmen Square couldn't have happened without the fax machine, the Arab Spring climate tragedy will be a spring again, whatever, couldn't have happened without Facebook and Twitter. But this is a story about another form of media and Twitter. So the radio program that we have, which is Women's Media Center Live, and which is syndicated in this country, but most important, is online with iTunes and with WMCLive.com, is about 3 years old and is kicking out every jam we can possibly find. During the Saudi women's attempt to drive, this is the third one. When they first tried in the 1990s, I became friends with those women, I knew those women, and remained in touch with them over the years. Then a whole new crop of women tried again. About a year and a half ago, they made another attempt to drive in Saudi Arabia. This time the ruling came down from the palace, which of course is completely independent from the judicial system, you understand, that they were not going to be treated, quote, lightly. In other words, had their jobs taken away, had their passports taken away, and been jailed. This time it was going to be considered, because it provoked civil unrest, it was going to be considered a capital offense. Well, in Saudi Arabia, capital offenses are, I mean, in other words, it was going to, I'm sorry, it was going to be considered an uprising against the state, and which is a capital offense. So the women whom I had interviewed by phone the previous week called me and texted me and said, we have to call it off because, you know, it's not worth losing our lives over. And we're really sorry. And I said, don't be sorry. We'll have protests all around the world in support of you anyway. And so we aired the segment, and I said in the segment that women were demonstrating, in fact, all around the world, which they were, at embassies. Soraya was in D.C., and consulates, and all across Europe and all across. And then I realized, this was before we were on iTunes, and so I realized, well, how are they going to know that it's on the website? So I threw it up on Twitter. I didn't know that there had been a complete media blackout in Saudi Arabia once the the demonstration had been called off. So they didn't know, and they didn't know that they were not all alone. But they went on Twitter, and they discovered that the program was up with their interview and that women were demonstrating around the world. They downloaded the program, they listened, and it was short enough so they could attach it to an email. It was one woman in Saudi Arabia, and she sent it to a friend, and she sent it to a friend, and she sent it to more friends, and like prairie fire all across Saudi Arabia. And you know what? 24 hours later, they got in their cars and they drove. So that's the power of media, and that's the power of this tool that's in our hands. And for all of its problems, I celebrate it anyway. Let's take a break and then we'll come back and have more fun.
I will try to keep a speakers list, so raise your hands if you would like to speak. And Nancy and Steph have microphones. It would be great to wait to grab the microphone because we're recording this for posterity, yes. And that way people will be able to hear the questions.
Hi, I'm Kaya. I'm a student here at Dartmouth. I just wanted to know, in talking about like Twitter and you know the movements that go on, there have been, like you said, the Black Lives Matter was started by three black women, and there have been other like hashtags and movements that are started by women of color, but they often get overshadowed a lot of times by like white feminist movements and things like that. So how do you deal with that, like as a woman of color, when you're trying to get your voice out there and then your voice gets overshadowed?
I get mad? No. I'm really upset? No, that's a really good question. I don't know that it has an exact answer. That doesn't happen to me a lot. I don't know why. This definitely happens to other women of color feminists I know. I don't know if that's just because I'm writing specifically about sexual assault and domestic violence and those types of issues when I'm entering sort of the feminist space. Not that this is all not the feminist space, but I don't get so much overshadowed by white feminists. I just think it's part of it is not shutting up. part of it for me is when they attempt to do that, and it's not it's not painting a broad brush that all white feminists are doing this particular thing, but there are certain moments where, particularly in the mainstream media. You know, if you think about the campus sexual assault movement and you think about what the face of that movement is, it's a white woman, right? But it's not that only white women are being sexually assaulted or only women are being sexually assaulted. It's that, you know, the media chooses to pick sort of, right. A white version of a woman and say, like, oh, poor these right. white women that are being raped. And if the face was a woman of color, it wouldn't have the same sort of appeal, to the mainstream media in terms of ad revenue, I guess, right? And ratings. So for me, part of it is just not shutting up and not ever ceding the space and ceding the argument. And just knowing that my, particularly because I'm talking about it from a personal perspective, that my point of view is valid, whether or not they think it is or not. I think that there is a very vibrant debate on, especially on Twitter, between women of color feminists and white feminists, and that's very generalizing. But I don't really enter that conversation unless like I'm being personally called out or something. Right. I try to stay out of that and then just stay in my lane. So maybe that's one approach, because I think that larger conversation, while critically important, I prefer it to be done in a private sort of. Like personal one-on-one interaction, like I have an issue with you, you said this and this hurt me, because sometimes in Twitter especially, it can get just like people sort of subtweeting and talking past each other. So one of the ways I try to deal with it is staying in my own lane, not shutting up, like being focused on the issue that I'm talking about and how I'm trying to add my voice to that conversation strategically. Like law school helps sort of with my brain. Like I'm always like speaking with a purpose. I'm not just speaking, and so that's how I think I can protect myself a little bit from that sort of like ongoing back and forth that happens between sort of white feminism and women of color, online specifically.
I'm 100% with you. I don't engage publicly in that way because it's not productive to me. I'm also very strategic with the time and the words that I choose, yeah. and also engage in a lot of really much more productive conversations in other spaces. Yeah. I personally have real problems, again, with the binary language of black and white feminism. I think it obscures yeah. other issues, particularly mm-hmm. class,
yeah.
and is not very helpful, again, as a brown person who's not one place or the other, mm-hmm. and the demographics in this country are changing, and our language is not, and it's really contributing to the problem instead of helping us find other solutions. So the other thing I will add is that one of the reasons I'm on the Women's Media Center board and on the others, one is focused on diversity in children's books. One is focused on mainstream kind of media. Another one is focused on new technology media, is because in every single one of them we have the exact same lack of diversity. And we need to talk about that lack of diversity as a matter of journalistic ethics. It's not, right now it's some kind of HR problem.
Right, right, right.
Mm-hmm. Right, and right. that's bullshit.
Right.
Right? It's not an HR problem. It's the problem with everything we see on the street every day. And until we can recast it that way, through activism, media activism, I mean, if you have time, you don't have a lot of time and you need to prioritize, I would strongly urge you to engage in that kind of activism because you can do it yourself. Mm-hmm. You can do it in Twitter, you can do it in Facebook, you can do it amongst your friends, you know, because the individual acts are insufficient. They really do need to be systemic. And they need to really be confrontations of these things.
Yeah, I think for me, from a personal perspective, if I feel...
Nice ring.
Thank you very much.
if I feel my work or my voice is maybe going to be co-opted, or like I'm very strategic about what I'll say where and like who I'll say mm-hmm. a thing with, or like I'm at a point where I don't necessarily talk about. I told a friend this, but I won't really like tweet a bunch of things in a row anymore if they're like ideas that I'm working through. I'll say like if this is enough for me as a black woman to write like six tweets about. I need to sit down and I need to write right. that piece. Mm-hmm. And that like mm-hmm. protects my sort of intellectual mm-hmm. thought, the, like intellectual labor of a black woman in a particular way. And so I think there's partly like being strategic about what you share, when you share what you're developing and how you do that. Mm-hmm. And I think from a broader angle, I've tried to be really thoughtful and strategic about like sharing other black women's stories. So like yeah. in the position that I have as a writer with a particular right. platform, being sure that when I write about Ferguson, I'm writing about the women at the front lines and like how they've been shaping that labor from the beginning. And so I think there are ways that like you can protect yourself and also amplify the work of other people and be strategic in both of those ways at the same right. time.
Men are more than twice as likely to be retweeted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I actually have a ratio. I'm like, well, I've got to offset that problem.
Yeah.
Me in my little office, right? Yeah. Like, but that's got to happen. Like, mm-hmm. we have to do that for each other, right? And it's not, I mean, there are brilliant men whose work I love, but I may not tweet them the same way because I don't need to. There are 10 other people doing right. that, right?
I know. And they all retweet each other. I mean,
and they all retweet
like,
each other,
great
right?
piece, good yeah. job. Like, all
right.
day,
and,
all day.
And that's fine. It's just that we have the imbalances we're talking yeah. about, and we need to address those imbalances through action. So,
yeah. And I think one quick thing is also just not seeing other women, and in particular other black women, as competitors, but as collaborators.
Yeah. yeah.
Like, intentionally being like, I think that the work you're doing is incredible. And I'm doing something that I like. Look, let's bring it together and let's be really intentional and thoughtful about this. I think has been such a rewarding and powerful thing that I've been just discovering throughout.
Right. And I have to say this because I think like you, people don't know if I'm a woman of color. I swear to God. Sometimes I am, sometimes I'm not. I'm like, do whatever you want, right? I can't change that. Usually they think I'm Muslim. I'm an atheist Christian. Right? So that is more about them than it is about me. And what I find in this conversation about white feminism and black feminism is that there are a lot of people thinking hard, but they don't know what to do. That's one category of person. Mm-hmm. Then there's people who aren't thinking at all, and yeah. they're full of ideas of what to do.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's really true.
And you need to know who's who yeah, yeah. because you need to find your people, yeah. right? Like, I know that there are places where I will not be able to write. I won't, because it's just not a place that's ever going to look at what I write and say, oh, sure, we will definitely yeah. take that piece of writing. But I have friends who are writing, and I'm like, I can't write this. You need to go write this, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Because it needs to be written, and you need to write it. Yeah. And I can do that, you know? So
I want to add a tiny PS here as the token European American up on the panel, which is that the best feminist writing, not black feminist or white feminist or any kind of adjectival feminism. The best feminist writing that is being done today in this country and maybe anywhere in the world, I can think of some candidates in other countries, is being done by women of color. Crunk Collective. I think
Brittany's been here.
My God, just so many people. I mean, and not only black women. Kim Crenshaw was here too. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But not only African American women. Is it Sui Park?
Yeah.
Yeah, who's fantastic, Asian American. The Wise Latina website. There's a whole incredible, renaissance of feminist thought and energy and creativity and tactics and strategy and vision, and it's coming, the leadership is coming from women of color. So it's good for everybody who's feminist, and people who are not feminist should learn to be feminist.
Yeah. Yep.
So I'm just wondering if y'all can speak to how Twitter and your writing and activism in general, how feminism can include solidarity with trans women, especially trans women of color, given the violence that is happening every day and their unjustified murders. Just interested in hearing about the solidarity and what we can do there.
So I was at a rally in DuPont Circle on Tuesday night for trans women of color. And I live in Washington, D.C. I go to I try and go to as many as I can to be supportive, because the fact is rallies for women's rights don't garner a lot of attention. They just don't, right? And so I was really heartened because it was an incredibly diverse group of people, much more diverse than I think it would have been 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And the activism and the writing that I do online, I think, gains its power from what's happening not online. And I don't really have a way of answering your question except to say that I'm hopeful, because I see a lot of change. I see a lot more diversity, which is important overall, right? And I actually think what's happening offline is more important right now than what's happening in Twitter. I don't know how else to put it. Like, we can all write. I mean, I have all kinds of privilege. I'm a cisgendered woman, been mm-hmm. happily married for like 25 years, right? That's not my world. I know mm-hmm. that, but I can be supportive. And the way I choose to be supportive myself is not to necessarily write about what it's like to be a trans woman, because I don't know that. But I can support the writing of trans women. I can share their writing. I can go to a rally. I can tell people to come with me. That's just my personal approach.
I mean, one thing I try to do, I mean, just retweeting women.
Right.
Retweeting trans women, so that's Trans Grio, that's Janet Mock, that's anything yeah. Laverne Cox tweets. But then also I think, we're at a moment right now where there's the visibility for trans women, particularly women of color. And I'm thinking, so we're in a week where you just had Bruce Jenner have his big interview. And sort of talk about how he wants to be defined and his gender nouns and all those things, pronouns and all those things. And that actually sparked a bigger conversation in the country. But before that, women of color, trans women of color, were the faces sort of the movement, right? I'm talking about Janet Mock and Laverne Cox, specifically in the past year or two.
Right.
And I think that Janet started a conversation on Twitter with the hashtag Girls Like Us. And then even after that, when she wrote her memoir, I think it was last year, Redefining Realness. So when you go to those two hashtags on Twitter, there's trans women of color, but all people sort of engaging on those issues. And that's why I say, like, whenever you're sort of thinking about an issue, even if it's like fashion, right, or exercise, finding the hashtag on Twitter where a conversation is taking place is a good way not only to be keyed in, but also to then find ways to engage offline, like Soraya said.
Right.
So I think that the visibility for trans women of color is an interesting moment because you have sort of the conversation about trans issues being led by women of color as opposed to other conversations that we've sort of had historically. So it's an interesting moment, and I, Janet Mock always says, like, it's they're not having a moment. she says we have to keep the moment going. Right. It's not you don't want it to just be a one-off sort of moment.
And I will say one thing too. There's, you know, we see the silhouette as the black silhouette, and we need to be looking at the white space around that more effectively, because how many people here know what missing white woman syndrome is? Okay. Mm-hmm. Missing white woman syndrome is a thing in media, which is something we all know, but it has a name, and it is that when a young white girl or woman goes missing, the whole country looks for her. Mm. The whole country will look for this child, right? Which is important, but there are many missing black girls of color, and nobody ever hears about them. And so again, when I think about, okay, what can I do to make the world more humane for a trans woman of color, it is to say, hey, media hierarchy here, mm-hmm. who's just kind of interested in that white girl because she suits your idea of pure womanhood and, you know, rape mythologies and protective masculinity and all that other stuff, you need to stop what you're doing and call them out. So it's not just saying, I'm going to support this trans woman. It's actually backing up and saying, what's inhibiting her from leading a safe and humane life? And it is this construction of our political life and our history and our media world. It's all systems. Dynamically related.
Yeah.
It's all of the systems.
Yeah, I definitely think that it's a two-part thing, right? Like, how do we support individual trans women while they're alive and on this earth? Like, how do we show up for them, and how do we not just remember their names in rallies and vigils? And I think that looks like a lot of different things, like sharing people's writing, supporting their work, like signal boosting things that are happening, and like showing up in solidarity in the ways that are difficult, right? So when it involves a conversation with your family member who's saying something, and you're like, that's not actually, that's not okay, and like, I know internally that it's not okay, and you might look at me some type of way if I have this conversation, like, that, the discomfort that I might feel in that moment when my mom or somebody is like, I don't understand, is wildly different and significantly less than the violence that trans women of color are facing. So like, that's just something that I, somebody who doesn't have that experience, have to suck up and deal with. And like, that's what showing up for people is, and it's what I hope people do when they're in solidarity with me. And then in terms of looking at a more systemic focus, like, trans women have been here. So like, when we write our stories, like, not starting journalism or any sort of media narrative about trans women with Bruce Jenner or with Janet Mock, right. But saying like, how have we erased trans women from our stories? Mm-hmm. How have we talked about Stonewall as this thing that was like this cute little like mm-hmm. parade, mm-hmm. but like was actually a riot and started against the police, like led by low-income trans women of color? Like, how, like, honoring trans women throughout history, in particular trans women of color, in the way that we build narratives, I think is extremely important. And it's in a way that is both honest about the ways that they've been written out and the violence they face, and also like celebratory, is something that I've been really thinking about and challenging myself to. Kind of.
I have a question. Hi, my name is Alexis and I teach here. This is for Zerlina, but it could be actually for anyone. You said you were actually on the Hannity show 10 times. Is that right?
What I was saying was that the situation of going writing something or doing a segment that is followed by death threats has happened like 10 times.
Okay, so I mean, obviously, rape and guns is a red meat issue for Fox viewers, and I'm guessing anything could have, you know, elicited that response. But I'm curious what the other 10 issues were that you spoke to, and whether it was just always the same kind of response, or whether they were nuanced. Differences.
You probably 8 of the 10 times were about sexual assault and on domestic violence, because I write about that a lot and also get threats as a result. Anytime I write about sexual assault, I'll get a rape threat, pretty much like clockwork, pretty sexist or racist comments. I mean, even if it's not a threatening one, it could be something really dismissive or objectifying. And I would say that the other times I've gotten sort of threatening messages, it's when I was talking about maybe Black Lives Matter or race, right? So, you know, all connected to certain media narrative that we've been talking about all night, which is sort of white, male, and cisgendered. And so essentially when I'm speaking to issues that, and from my perspective, which is just different from that sort of default white male cisgendered perspective, I get pushback. And it depends upon how sensitive the topic is. And then I'll get more pushback if it's something like that. I mean, I knew going in that that was going to be bad. I'm not under any illusions that that debate was not going to end sort of in a shit show. But I knew sort of strategically at that moment that it was important to put that idea in that space because they were having, this was after Newtown, right? This is in 2013. So after Newtown, the NRA and sort of conservative types, Gail Trotter testified on Capitol Hill at the assault weapons ban hearing. They were pushing this narrative that if you gave every woman a gun, it would end
and
domestic
now on
violence.
Campuses.
Right, and now on campuses. And so it was important for me to go into that space and be like, no, that's wrong, stop. Shut up. It's not if I had, you know, 5 more minutes in that segment, then it would be like, no, do you want me to end up like Marissa Alexander and then get sentenced to 20 years in prison if I shoot my abuser and then there's no one to testify on my behalf of what transpired, right? So there's I think that those moments when it's sort of like really heated, I anticipate sort of the reaction. When I wrote that for the Washington Post, as soon as I filed it, I left and went to brunch. Because I knew, I wasn't looking at my mentions that day because I knew it was going to be terrible. I mean, actually, in response to that, one of the hashtags that somebody started, when I said, because it was, we should generally believe rape claims, and so people started the hashtag, Zerlina Maxwell raped me, and started tweeting that at me.
Right.
And so
people looking for you. I remember.
Yes. No.
Like
people
you went
were
to brunch and then
looking for me. They were like, they were looking up bar applications and like, it was pretty bad. But I would say that when I choose to write something or go into a debate where I know it's going to be heated, I'm sort of prepared now, as opposed to when I wasn't for the Hannity so much. But it's usually sexual assault or something race related.
This is a question that'll sort of start with Robin, but it's kind of more open-ended. But I was curious about satire, or that's what got me thinking about it. For people who are not in the choir, what are the dangers you see of subtle critique of something? My background is in film. I choose the films that play at the campus, and one of the things that I'm always looking for is the critique so subtle that people who are not in the choir will get the exact opposite message of what you're hoping they'll get? And so I guess I'm wondering, I mean, sort of in relation to the death threats you receive from people who aren't in the choir, mm-hmm. when you're trying to raise a call of action to people who aren't in the group, what are the dangers of the message being received the wrong way from people who aren't already initiated in that dialogue of critique? And Robin, since you mentioned satire, that also.
What an interesting question. It's really a great question. I try, and I can only speak for myself, but I cast as wide a net as I can in fishing for souls. I don't know why I'm quoting St. Peter. but so that there is something for the choir, usually the passion in the piece and the rage, but that it is explanatory enough or inviting enough or hopefully well-written enough to welcome, somebody from the outside. The people who will hate me from the beginning and all of us, I'm not addressing because they're not going to change. The real haters, okay? But there are still a whole lot of people who are thinking, well, doesn't feminism mean you hate men? Isn't it all about anti-men? So there are people that you still, want to address. But humor is a hell of a brilliant good way if you can pull it off because it is welcoming. I wrote a piece, for example, on religious fundamentalism, which was my modest proposal.
It was great.
Thank you. It was one of my good ones, I must say. I noticed the Merck manual, not the Merck manual, DSM manual had just come out for about psychology and how they every year, every 2 years, I guess it is, the American Psychological Association does this whole new categorization of mental illnesses and emotional disturbances. And I was looking at it, and I realized, gee whiz, religious fundamentalists fit so perfectly. They just absolutely match. So I went through it. And it was sort of each one. It was paranoia. It was delusions of grandeur. It was schizophrenic, complete depersonalization. It was an amazing fit. And I did it as funny as possible. And I just, started by saying, well, for years I've been trying to think, well, these people, are ill-educated, or they're hating because of this, or they're hating because of that. And in fact, it's a mental disturbance, and why didn't I realize that? It was after this piece came out, and then in subsequent versions I've incorporated it, that I learned that the when they put together the manual, the one exception that they make for hallucinations, delusions, paranoia, et cetera, are religious people. So that was an additional irony that I had not anticipated. But I did another one which pulled a lot of hate down online, which was about guns and about how many guys, including obviously especially the NRA, confused body parts of themselves with guns. In the Army, for example, there is literally a training song that says, this is my rifle, this is my gun. One is for killing, one is for fun, with appropriate gestures. And this is cross-cultural, I might add, as you find a version of this in every country. So this was a whole thing about how gentlemen who will not give up their guns because their identity was so close to guns and their penises were so close to guns, that they were afraid when we outlawed guns, we were outlawing penises. So it was meant as, it was titled A Reassurance to Men, that we are not outlawing your penises, that there will be no government regulation of your penises, that we do recommend that you don't carry your penises in, visibly into school grounds, playgrounds, and churches and other places. We also don't think that we actually agree that concealing your penises is a good thing, except that not when you're using them as a lethal weapon. We also feel that oiling and caring for your guns or your penises is perfectly fine, although amassing a whole collection of them is problematical. And it went on this way. I had such fun doing it, I have to tell you. I mean, I just absolutely blew a gasket. And up it went, and my God, there were a great many men who did not think that was funny. These are men who have for years said feminists have no sense of humor. Right. So I was very, very serious when I was young, even despite the introduction that had me as this wild-eyed, insouciant, crazy, wonderful person. I wish I had been, but I was actually very serious. I've learned to be funnier as I've grown more serious and older. So I think that's a real way of using it and using satire. It lures people in because it's funny. And humor goes places nothing else can go. And it reassures and validates the people who are already in the choir, who get a rare chance to actually laugh at the patriarchy, laugh at the adversaries. So I don't know what other people feel.
I think since it's 5:30 now, I want to end by thanking you all for galvanizing us, entertaining us, informing us, and thank you. Okay.
And before everybody goes, I just want to make a quick note that a bunch of students are going to be marching in solidarity with Baltimore right outside of this building from about 5:30 to 6. They're going to be hanging out here, getting you all, and then walking towards the green. So if you want to join in on that, please do feel free to. There's extra signs.